and I'm going to cover what is data microservices. Right? So the thing is, knowing that you have had an understanding around what is the whole microservices thing and how is customers actually adapting to this new culture of moving from monolith to microservices. So what we thought was, it'll be good to actually present to you guys. It's not just about the applications. You also need to look at applications and data as two, as one thing rather than separating them. How many of you here have at least worked a bit on databases, at least or NoSQL databases or Hadoops or? Not bad. So most of you are more into development, is it? Don't really interact, with the database stuff as such. Interesting. Okay. So we have very few people. We will try and make it much more easy for you guys to understand for those who are not coming from the database background. But again, the concept is kind of very interesting. Like I said, if you look into all these big internet giants like Google, Facebook, Yahoo, the way how they design things is not that they only look at applications. They look at applications and data together. As applications start generating more data, you collect all this data, and then you try to find insights in it and make your applications even better. So that's what the talk is all going to be. Again, we'll try to keep it short and sweet, so at least you're not bored. So before we start, myself, I'm Vish Fanindra. I actually run the data engineering here at Pivotal for the South Asian market. So I handle both the pre and post sales organization here at Pivotal. I've been with this company for about 10 years. Right? So Carlos, you want to just introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm with Pivotal as well. I'm a solutions architect. So I'm more in the PCF side, deploying PCF, and show people how to deploy apps, Spring-based apps, Spring Waterfall apps on PCF, on using microservices.
Okay, that's my Twitter handle. So before we start, just want to take a step back and just want to demystify a bit around what exactly, why are we doing this now? What exactly is this microservices? What is this data microservices? The idea here is, if you look into the whole the new enterprise world, right, especially some of these companies that are moving into Agile or adapting DevOps, are looking at all these big monolithic applications where they're trying to break them down to microservices architecture. So one thing is very clear, right? The thing is, the time it takes, everyone has ideas, right? The time it takes for you to be able to make this a reality, make this idea into a reality, and then being able to make money out of it is the whole thing, right? You can have n number of ideas, but then if you really can't make revenue out of it, then there's no point. So this is the concept, what we call as concept of cash, right? Where you really have this idea, and I want to do something, materialize it, and make it real. And at the end of the day, start taking that, innovating on the idea that is out there. So it's a kind of iterative process. So historically, we all started with waterfall methodology, and then we moved into Agile practices, then lean practices. Then as we started getting mature, we started looking at CI, CD, ultimately, talked about continuous deployment.
Who is doing CI, CD here, continuous deployment? Mainly.
Very few. So again, going back to all these consumer-grade companies, like Amazon, like Netflix, these guys, they kind of push release code to production every few minutes, several times in a day, right? So this is kind of iterative process. And if you look into this, right, there is one, the evolution of this has one common characteristic, which is the shorter the release cycles are, the software quality is improved. Because you're basically taking a bigger problem deconstructing that problem into smaller problems, and you're attacking at each one of those rather than looking at a bigger picture, right? Whereas on the other side, where the traditional way of building applications, waterfall model, where your release cycles are at least like 9 months or a year. After 1 year, things would have changed, the market has changed. You really have no control, and it's like building bridges, right? There's this talk by Onsi from Pivotal. So just recently we conducted the Spring One conference in Vegas. He talked about help developers do what they love, right? This is an amazing talk. Everyone should watch it. It's up on YouTube. Just look for Onsi, O-N-S-I. So he had, it's a 15, 20 minutes talk. I kind of really loved it. My background is more into data, really talking about big data, analyzing the data. So I'm more into the analytics space, not really into the development space, but I kind of really loved what he said. It's like building bridges, right? You take years to do this, right? From a software perspective, you can't really think that long. You got to really be looking at doing things very iteratively and very fast. So that's the idea here. So one thing is very clear, if you're going agile, generally in a traditional monolithic architecture, you have hundreds of developers. All these developers tend to work on one big thing. And the challenge is, all these developers tend to work in a dependent mode. They can't work independently. Whereas on the other side, what you're doing is you're deconstructing it, you're making it a microservice architecture, where each one is like a service, and you have smaller agile teams really focusing on building that one thing. It's more or less like, there's been this talk about this SOA, and now we talked about microservices. There is some kind of convergence between SOA and the microservices. But the point is, the smaller the teams are, they're more focused. They're kind of independently trying to build things. And the beauty here is that you're not really going with what we call as one big giant database. From a database world, your applications are not just trying to hold the data, the complex data models that you build, and the way how you store data from these applications is not just in one location. Because the moment you try to deconstruct this into a microservices-based architecture, the idea is you're going to pick a right tool for the right job. So which means one service would probably use a NoSQL database, one service would probably use a simple SQL like MySQL or Postgres or whatever it may be, right? So the idea is, with this new architecture, we're talking about polyglot persistence, where you have a lot of tools that are out there or backends that are out there that you could actually persist the data in, and you're not sticking with one big giant database. Now, the moment you deconstruct this into a microservices architecture, then if you're running this in a platform, like structured platform, like Cloud Foundry, how many of you have heard of Cloud Foundry? Today, Josh covered about Cloud Foundry. So again, Cloud Foundry being a structured platform, being able to deploy these services become much easier. So you see a lot of things like updates and upgrades and scaling your applications and your persistent layers horizontally, and being able to migrate them to a new environment or being able to redeploy them and redistribute them. All of this becomes much easier with Cloud Foundry. And the beauty again here is, this Cloud Foundry becomes like an abstraction between your infrastructure and your microservices, which means you could easily change your infrastructure. So in the past, it was all about your applications are tightly coupled with your infrastructure. Any change, that version upgrade, anything that has to happen, there's a lot of panic between the developers and the operations team because everyone has their own KPIs, right? With this approach, you're really talking about automating all the activities. Now, again, from an enterprise architecture point of view, if you look into it, traditionally you have all these big monolithic systems. As you start growing all these systems, then you would end up introducing things like integration bus or enterprise service bus. So the integration bus or enterprise service bus really helps in moving data from one system to the other. As they start getting bigger and bigger, then your enterprise bus becomes the key for all the integration points between these systems. And the challenge then is, if you change one system, which means all the other systems will have impact, which means you need to have a team of people who is managing all these integration bus or enterprise service bus, and also to make sure that all these impact analysis is done for every change that is being done on any of these systems. And if you look into the left-hand side of it, we kind of re-scoped it to a microservices-based architecture, but if you look into the other systems, you have all these big, giant databases trying to generate a lot of data, and all this data then has to go into a platform like data warehouse, which is where all the data gets collected and analyzed and used for management reporting. So that's where you introduce another set of tools like ETL, if you've heard of ETL. If you haven't heard of ETL, it's an extract, transform, and load. So you introduce another piece of software, which means you have this huge problem where your data warehouse holds D-1, which means yesterday's data, which is what management is using for doing their decision making. And on top of it, this system has to be able to help business to make decisions, and this system has to give feedback to the applications, which is not really a right approach to start with. Because like I said earlier, the idea is applications generate data. You collect data, you try to find insights in that data, make your applications better, which in turn will generate more data. That's what all these commercial, consumer-grade companies like Google, Facebook, Yahoo, all these guys are doing the same thing, right? So with this, you have a problem where you don't have data available in real time, which means your analysis is not kind of accurate. Now, if we zoom into this and really look at the data pipelines, so whether it's an integration bus or whether it's an ETL tool, you have data coming from one system and you're moving it to another system. In between, you end up doing a lot of processing steps. What I mean by that is you could probably do data filtering, you could probably do some kind of data transformation, you could probably do multiple things before it lands into the destination. So the challenge here is, if we kind of deploy this into an architecture where which is kind of traditional monolithic, if I have to change one processing step, which is what I was mentioning earlier, any change that has to happen requires a lot of impact analysis, because it's not straightforward. It requires you to go look at how is this data going to be used by other systems, which is a huge mammoth task to start with. So, which means it's the updates and upgrades and scalability, all these becomes a problem. The one most important thing, I'm sure you all know this, no one cares about day zero thing. It's about day zero or day one, whatever you call it. Day two is what is important. So you build a cool application, you deploy into production. That's not where the real work starts, about how do I manage this, how do I really make this better. Right? So it's all about day two operations. With this kind of architecture, all the data operations, the upgrades and scalabilities and redeploying it, all this becomes really a complex task. So what we are seeing is to basically break this into a bunch of Spring Boot apps, right, where you have each processing step an app with a proper contract. Right? So if you look into this Spring Boot, so you have this abstraction layer. I was talking earlier about Pivotal Cloud Foundry. So you have different kinds of messaging queues or in-memory cache layers that you would actually use. with this Spring Boot, you know, all these contracts of the microservice architecture. So the data pipeline or the abstraction layer, everything is kind of automized. Right? It's automatic. Once you bind the service to a specific app, it kind of starts moving the data from one app to the other.
Yeah, you want to add something there?
Here, I don't know if you heard about, this is what they call Spring Cloud Stream. This is one of the Spring products that you have, Spring libraries. And what makes it cool here is that those guys are completely independent, right? So they don't need to know each other. So they only need to know how to send the data over or how to receive the data. So they are completely independent, running completely independent. So they can, you can scale this one, you can scale down that one, and so on. And the layer here, they bind the abstract layer that can be message queues like Kafka or RabbitMQ or Geode or Redis, and it moves the data between them. And then you can scale this layer as well. So you keep writing Spring Boot apps, but now, rather than you are doing business logic, you are doing processing the data. You can receive data in a stream flow or can be a batch. But this guy here, that's a Spring Boot application, is going to process that data for you. And he can send the data over using this abstraction layer here, make it very easy to program this. And if you are developing microservice, one very common way of moving data between microservices is what? Via REST APIs, right? Here, you don't have to rely on REST APIs. If you need asynchronous communication, in that make those microservices completely independent, you can use this. And the message layer here is going to move the data for you, right? This is make you very powerful because you as a developer doesn't have to change the way that you develop software. You still use Spring Boot as application. And Spring, you're going to inject the code for you that makes the data move between the services. So it's the same concept as before, but now with a more powerful technology that makes very easy to move data around microservices. That's why you call this data microservice, because you are specifically moving data between them and processing. And then you can layer them as here. The data is going from this guy, for example, for that one. So you create your data pipeline. And your data pipeline, you can transform your data as the data come. And then you can sync your data in a database, or you can send the data to someone else, and you can trigger another process. You can put things on as a Lego and create your data pipeline as you wish, making it very powerful because, for example, if you want to, this third service here wants to consume some data, doesn't have to ask this one. You can just pipe this guy straight to the bind and start to consume the data from there. You don't have to give this, this data doesn't have to know that. So make very easy and flexible, inject, process that particular data for you, and that doesn't impact the flow of your data pipeline. Your data pipeline is still there processing the data, and you can inject different apps to process different things. And your data pipeline doesn't have to change.
I think next one, it's the same.
Yes. Yeah. And here, that's the...
Sorry.
This is how you do this in Spring, right? So as you use, if you are a Spring user, pretty much put annotations in your code. So there, on the top, you have enabled binding. What that means, processor annotation there, it means that this is a processor. This is receive data from someone, process the data, and send to someone else. Who you're receiving from, you don't know. Who you're sending to, you don't know, because this is going to happen when you bind your Spring Boot applications together. That time that you do this, that you create your pipeline, then the data is going to start to flow.
So this basically talks about the previous slide. So again, this kind of talks about you know, deploying these Spring Boot apps into a platform like Cloud Foundry, which not only allows you to make it transport transparency, but it also allows you to make your infrastructure to be transparent. It kind of has all the integrated metrics, and it has all the integration monitoring, yes. And it comes with aggregated logging, auto healing. So you have containers, you kill one, and it will automatically start the other container. So that it comes with a lot of goodness, especially from a Cloud Foundry perspective, which kind of automates all your applications and kind of binds your applications with your data services.
And one detail here is that
Yes, you can deploy this in Cloud Foundry, but you can test this today in your laptop without Cloud Foundry. Why you want to deploy this in Cloud Foundry? Because you want to aggregate logs. You want to have high availability and so on that the platform can give to you. Then you as a developer doesn't have to worry about this, right? The platform can give you the message layer that you're going to bind your applications to it. So you don't have to worry about this. But of course, if you want to test those things running, you can test in your laptop. And then you go production, and you put in a platform that they're going to put those things for you, and they're going to keep those things running for you, right? That's the powerful of Spring. The same data that's here that you test in your laptop is the same code that's going to go live. No change. You don't need to change anything, right? And you can run in your laptop today or in a platform like Cloud Foundry. No change in your code. This is the powerful that comes from there. From the annotation of Spring, from the injection code for you, depending on which platform you are.
So this is the Spring Cloud data pipeline. Carlos, you want to touch on this?
Yes. So you saw a bit of Spring Cloud Stream, right?
So that's is a library from Spring Cloud that you use to bind applications together, or if you want to call data microservices together, to move data between applications. On top of Spring Cloud Stream, you have what you call Spring Cloud Data Flow. When you saw Spring Cloud Stream, you still have to write some code and bind this to the message layer and so on. Spring Cloud Stream abstract this for you, give you a higher level of creating your pipeline. You now can create your pipeline using a DSL language that's make very easy to say, I want to connect a HTTP server output with a processor that gets the output from the HTTP server, process this, and sends to a database. You can mix and match and create different pipelines using a console, a command line, using the DSL provided by Spring Cloud Data, making very, very easy to create pipelines. I will just give you a very, very quick example how this can work. So let's... Yeah.
Is Carlos audible to everyone? You hear him?
So let me... Yes, I'm trying to. Just 1 second. So here is the console of Dataflow. They call the Dataflow shell. This is how we interact with that layer that I show you. Here you can create pipelines. You can say, I want to put a server, HTTP server, that receive requests. Whatever someone sent that request to me, I want to capture that request. I want to do something with that request, transform from CSV to JSON to XML, whatever you want to do there. And then the output of this processing, I want to send to a database, or I want to send to a file, or I want to send to a log and to a file, or I want to send to my Hadoop cluster, and so on. You can do this orchestration, how your data move around, just using this console. That's the power of Spring Cloud Data Flow. It abstracts to you a lot of code that you have to write to bind those things. Of course, when you bind things here, that software, that application has already to be there, right? But once that you have a collection of them, that's what Spring Cloud Data Flow gives you, you can use them and to orchestrate your data pipeline. So, data flow, here you have a server that just manage your applications. It doesn't run your applications for you. The ESB, you're going to be there to move your applications around. This guy here is just an orchestrator. He just connects things. He doesn't move any data around. He just say, hey, A goes to B, then goes to C. That's it. How the data goes to A from B is not his job. Is the message layer job. So the ESB does this, does the security, does everything. And that's why it becomes a big monolith, because he wants to do everything. These guys here only does one thing, orchestrate how the applications connect to each other. That's the bind, but doesn't do any more than this. Doesn't move the data around. Hadoop, this is the message layer that's provided by someone else, that if you are in Cloud Foundry, you can use the message layers that they provide, like Kafka, like WrapMQ, and so on.
So now it's actually, it still relies on underlying services.
Yeah, you have each service doing what they do best, right? So you need to move data around. So you have Kafka that moves data around very fast. Can persist the data, is durable, so you can replay and so on. Nice feature that they give that for you. You can use that to move your data around. When you develop your application, you don't have to know about this. You just say, I want that my application receive from A and send to B. How the data is going to move, if you're going to use Redis to move the data, or Kafka, or you're going to use WrapMQ, it's not your job. It's how you're going to deploy this. When you orchestrate your things, you can say, yes, I want to use Kafka for this job, or for this pipeline. But for the other pipeline, I want to use WrapMQ and so on. So the developer, if you are developing your application that receives data from a third party, you don't have to worry about, I'm going to receive from a Kafka endpoint. I have to send this to a file. You just say, I have an input source, I have an output source. That's it. When you bind things together using this guy here, they're going to connect to you to the message layer that you want to use for that particular pipeline.
So, okay, so I'm looking at an administrative part here,
That's why the platform does this for you, right? So those things, the message layer, the binding, the high availability of the applications, when you are running this in Cloud Foundry, they're going to provide this for you, right?
So all these services run as part of Cloud Foundry, right? Moment you push all these microservices, basically you're binding them together at the time of execution. You're not really writing your stuff based on one ESB or anything.
When you write for ESB, you write for that particular ESB,
yep.
Right? Most of the time. Even though they put standards together, but never work because, in my case you do this, in my case you do that. Here, the only thing that you say here, I'm writing a Spring Boot application. How they gonna run, if it's in Cloud Foundry, if it's in your laptop, if it's in Kubernetes, is how you decide, you as the manager or of the guy that manage the platform, you decide which platform you want to use and how you bind them. If you like WrapMQ to move data around, you use WrapMQ. If you like Kafka, use Kafka. If you don't like them, use as a third party, you can implement that and bring that over as well. So you as a developer don't have to worry about this. You as a manager or as the DevOps team or part of the DevOps team define where those guys are going to. If you're going to use Cloud Foundry, it will be physical servers. I want to put the things there. I have process, I have a Puppet Chef scripts that put those things up, put those things down, and monitor that for me. No changing the code is required. The same way that you interface with this guy, you're going to keep interface there. You are not binding to something. Only in runtime, you say, I want to run this in Cloud Foundry, I want to bind this to Kafka. Then you are telling that. That's the main difference, right?
It's about the flexibility that the platform offers for you to be able to quickly
So here, if I do a stream list, I see the pipelines that I have created so far. So I have here one very simple pipeline called foo that pretty much every second gets the time and sends over, and the log gets that time and sends to the log. Very simple pipeline. Here I have another one that's called tag count, another one called tweet length, and another one called tweets. Those are my complex pipelines because what I'm doing now is I'm getting the data from Twitter, and for the data that I get from Twitter, I'm processing that data, for example, to aggregate by hashtags, to aggregate by language. If people are speaking in English, if people are speaking Portuguese and Spanish and so on. So all those pipelines here was aggregated by me. But if you see here what I have used, there's a time application there, there's a log application there, there's a tweet stream application. These applications were not developed by me. Might be developed by someone of you. You develop your application as a Spring Boot application, put available for me there that I can use and match how I like. Right? So someone developed the tweet stream that connects to the Twitter firehose, get the tweets from that, that's it. Only does this, get the tweets. How you're gonna process the tweets is up to you. So I'm saying here, get those tweets, count them, and count them by hashtags. So now I'm putting something else. I'm using that to count my tweets and aggregate by hashtags. That the guy that developed the application Twitter doesn't even see that. You only say, the application only does one thing, connect to Twitter, get the tweets, that's all. Here, you are using these and all the applications putting together to do something that you want, to do some part of a data analysis. That's here, the data analysis, analyze the tweets. That you, when you deploy your application, you know about this, but someone that developed the Twitter stream only did one thing. Okay, let's connect to Twitter, pass your credentials, start to get the firehose there, and start to feed the tweeters in. How you want to do with Twitter? I could say here, get all the tweets sent to a database. Get all the tweets sent straight to Hadoop. Or process this and also send to Hadoop. Because I want to process this later as well. I'm processing this in real time. As the tweet comes, I'm processing this. But also I want to process this in real time. I want to process the hashtags for the last month, for the last year. My data is going to Hadoop in HDFS, it'll be there in HDFS, and also I'm processing online here. So you define what you want to do. You can have multiple streams coming, aggregate them, and you can have multiple outputs. Go to a database, relational database, go to a HDFS, and so on, file system, and so on. That's the power that you have here. You keep changing things and mixing things around. So if I, let me create a very simple application here. Just, I'm gonna deploy this full application here. Yeah, but say that. Connections. Let me not put these tweets to run. I'm deploying tweets. That's the one that I'm talking about. So what I'm doing now is, there's no connection there.
Oh, internet is not there?
Probably. Let me authenticate. So keep talking that I come back. I'm gonna come back to you this when I finish talk these slides because of the 5 o'clock.
Yeah. So while Carlos is fixing that, the other thing we have to look at is we talked about Cloud Foundry aspects where it helps you to be able to scale your applications automatically and it allows you to be able to quickly redeploy, I mean, migrate from one platform to other, all these things are kind of quite possible. And moving on, right, so if I were to, so this is something
just,
that...
To finish this up, so when I talk there, so here I create a pipeline, right? So JSON filter, a transformation in that JSON filter, send to Spark, process this in Spark, get the data back, and now I'm sending. Aggregating the data and send to Jolt, do something else and send to a relational database, right? This is my pipeline. This pipeline is a bunch of Spring Boot applications. JSON filter is a Spring Boot application. Transformer is a JSON, is a Spring Boot application. Each of those things in your pipeline is a Spring Boot application. So essentially what you create is a catalog of applications that you can use, can connect them together and create a pipeline. So data flow catalog has this list of catalog of applications for you that you can use to connect them to process your data. That's the main idea. And those apps, they run as Spring Boot apps. It means they can run in containers, they have high availability. If you are running this in Cloud Foundry, if someone crashed, they can restart. If they can restart, they can be deployed again and so on. So the platform can take care of the high availability that you don't have to. And the data keep moving around, right? That's the main thing. And for some reason, for example, if that transformers there stop to process. Let's say transformer here crashes, the data is not moving on. If you are using some message layer like as Kafka, what's going to happen? Kafka going to persist this. Then what you can do? Replay. Then you're going to replay and send the data again, and now you can process. Right? So you didn't have to develop none of this. Right? You are using the tools that are available to you to connect them together and create a pipeline like this. That's the powerful thing there.
If this crashes, then we can go to again.
Yes, if you're using a message layer, a message bus, like a message broker, like Kafka, you can replay your message because they persist the message and allow you to replay that.
This is the same thing that John talked about.
So the powerful here that because they can persist the own data there, you can replay, you don't lose the data if you have a problem that you are out for like 5 seconds, 10 seconds. If you are processing feed financial market that you don't want to lose for some reason, you could use some message persistence layer like Kafka that allows to have that persistence for you. If you don't care about losing data, you can lose a faster message layer that can lose data but process data fast. Then you decide how you want to connect this, right? You don't have to be binary. I bought that in ESB. I have to use the message that the transfer message that they give me. I cannot change anything because I have to use as it is. Here, you can connect things, right? And you can, the best tool for the job. If persistence, don't lose data is important for you, so you have to lose a message layer that passes the data and can replay that. If it's not important for you, you can lose something that everything's in memory. If you crash, if you lose, that's fine. You not die because you lose some data. Depending on what you want to do, you choose the tools that you want to work. And the same principle applies, the same way that you do this, always the same. You match them using the data flow shell that I show you. And then after that, they're going to deploy as Spring Boot apps and going to run independently. And they want to talk to, this guy doesn't know about this. The only thing that they know about is the message.
You want to show the UI to them?
So let's see if the connection is.
You might print to the internet?
Supposedly,
yes.
So this is the data flow UI. Before I show this, let me show just here. One thing that is just to give you a context that give you a high level architecture of those things, right? Where is that? The data flow that I show you.
Yep.
So this is the main architecture of Spring Cloud Data Flow, right? What I showed you was a shell that connects to this guy. It's also a Spring Boot application that can run locally in your machine or in a platform as Cloud Foundry. In this case here, I'm running in PWS. So this guy is running there in PWS. And then I have a shell in my machine, that's what you saw, that send requests, REST requests to talk to the admin here. And by doing requests, I can ask what you have deployed, I want to create a new stream to deploy, and so on, using the shell. If you don't want to use the shell, you might use the Flow UI. There's a graphic interface that you can create your pipeline graphically, just drag and drop. The guy, you're gonna talk to the server. And if you prefer to do things manually in a hardcore thing, you can use curl to send your requests, because it's just a bunch of REST endpoints, right? This is running somewhere, can be on a laptop, can be in Cloud Foundry or Kubernetes, whatever you want. This is how you interact with this guy. And this guy here now knows how, from receiving the requests, start the applications. If you say, I want to send time to log, meaning I have two applications, an application that generates time, application that saves the log. So there are two applications that this guy is going to say, hey, run two applications, whatever you are, inside Cloud Foundry. If inside Cloud Foundry, you're going to run this as containers that will be managed by Cloud Foundry. And those applications, this guy is going to say, hey, you have to talk to each other, so bind to the same message broker. then also depend of you, you can say the message broker that I want to use by UB Kafka or UB Rabbit and so on. By doing this, now you have two applications running inside Cloud Foundry that are talking to each other via message broker. Right? And then this guy here can monitor those applications, find out if the one crashes, or let's say that you have update. I did a new version of my application, now I have to upgrade. Then you can have canary upgrades here as well. So meaning that you don't have to put all the service down before upgrade that. So this is what the high-level architecture of Spring Cloud Dataflow. This is a Spring Boot apps. It's not something special. This is Spring Boot apps running on the Java JVM. Very, very, very simple, right? So the same technology that you write, that you use to write your microservice, your web applications, is the one that's here.
So far, are you guys on track with us? Okay, awesome. Okay. Back. So you want to show the UI now?
No, if the requests are coming, so. Okay, let me get the other one. Okay, this is the. This is the graph interface. This is how the other way that you can interact with Spring Cloud Dataflow. If you check here what you have, this is a list of our applications that I can use to create my pipelines. I have FTP SUS, what that means, that I can now have a FTP server or FTP client that connects to FTP server, copy the file over and bring to my pipeline. The output of that FTP can be a JDBC. It means you're going to open a JDBC connection to a database and save the content of that file inside the database. You created the pipeline as you wish, right? So if I go here on the streams that I have, so those streams here. Show you what you have, the same interface that you have in the command line there, you have here. And from here you can undeploy, you can deploy, you can destroy, remove the stream from here. It's kind of the same, is the same information but in a graphical way. So this is what they call about. And here, let's say that I develop a new application, right? So if I develop a new application, let's say I create a SUS. Meaning, I create an application that can consume data from Salesforce. So that application connects to the Salesforce using the Salesforce API and bring the data for my pipeline. So now I can create pipelines that has data from Salesforce. If you want to register that application to Cloud Dataflow, it means what? Now, someone that uses Dataflow can architect pipelines that has data from Salesforce, that has data from FTP server, that has data from Hadoop, and they can process the data together to give you something meaningful. I can register my application like this. So there are three types of applications in Spring Cloud Dataflow. So the task, we're gonna talk later about this, but here we'll talk about streams, moving the data from one point to the other. So you can have a SUS, it means that you consume your initial point of data inside the pipeline. This is the data that bring the data, is the guy that bring the data into the pipeline. It's a SUS. FTP can be a SUS, HTTP server can be a SUS, and so on. A file can be a SUS, and so on. These are the name of the application. A processor is something that receive data from one side and send the data to the other side. You can use a processor for what? For transform data. You receive XML, give JSP. Or you can aggregate data. You receive data here, then you aggregate by name, you aggregate by city, or as the tweets, you aggregate by hashtags, or you aggregate by language and so on. And then you have a sync. A sync is receive data and stop the pipeline there, because now the data will be persisted, or you're gonna be going out the pipeline. It means can go to a database. It means can go to a log. It means can go to a HFS system and so on. These are the three types of application that you can develop, and then you can create your data stream pipelines. That's why we call data microservice. Finally, they have a task there. That task is for what? Batch. Let's say that you want to do a batch job. Every 10 tweets that I receive, do aggregation using all my tweets from the last year. So it's a batch job that you're going to take longer. You're going to have to go to some place once the data is there and going to run. That's what they call a task. It's a batch job. And you can combine a batch job with your stream. And by doing this, also you can have trigger powerful things, right? Let's say that you are processing logs. You receive a log that has a failure, an error in the log. That error can trigger a batch job that will send an email or process something else or open a ticket, do something else that outside the pipeline. You can combine those things together. So that's the powerful things there. And this is how you rest your applications using the web interface. You can do this the same thing from the command line as well.
Okay. So you want me to just wrap it up?
Hey, keep going. So I want to see if I want this.
So probably three things that I want to summarize. Converging data in the cloud, in the applications and the data, they can't be separated. Building really data-driven apps, which means the smarter the apps are, the more the data gets generated, the better you can make, again, the smart app. So, and then being able to use OpenAI, I guess most of you, since if you're using Spring, you are kind of aware of the open source community and all of that. So Pivotal is really a big advocate of open source. We are, whatever products that we carry or offer to customers, all open sourced. And what we provide is just the support and the top value-added services on top of the products. Right? So it, we believe truly that all the enterprises, because now if you look into some of these consumer-grade companies, which I was referring to, Google, Facebook, they're able to rapidly innovate because they're all using open source. There's a huge community backing. The moment you are into commercial products, which means you're locking yourself, your innovation is totally dependent on how fast can that vendor that you have, the software product vendor, that is innovating, right? So it, the speed is all up to the vendor. But now with open source, you have a community. Agile is something that we also believe in, where shorter innovation cycles, it reduces the TCO, as well as the time to market gets improved. And lastly, now it's all about cloud ready. So you have to really look at all your applications to be running independent of your infrastructure. It should, whether you move your application to Amazon or whether you move your application to a private cloud, whatever be the case, it has to really be in a cloud ready, and you should really focus on solving more business problems rather than creating, you know, working on things that are already available in the market. So that's pretty much it. I have a few more slides, but I think this is really good enough. Probably Carlos will.
So if you have questions, you can. I'm gonna try to run the demo here. But if you have questions, why?
You have any questions, probably I'll take the questions. If not, probably Carlos will try to show that demo. The demo is actually quite cool. It will actually show, it will collect all the tweets by hashtag, and it starts showing the graph in real time. How are the tweets, what are the top hashtags in real time.
So just to show you some things here, for example, this is, I'm in my laptop here, so let me just get this.
There's a question there, yep. Yeah, so Spring Cloud Data Flow is the next version of XT. XT is going to be end of life next year.
So what?
Can they migrate to?
Yes, you can. What you did from Spring XD to Spring Cloud Data Flow, you remove the runtime. And the runtime now is a cloud platform, like Cloud Foundry or Kubernetes and so on. So that runtime business high availability and binding message brokers and so on, you left this with the platform. And now you focus only in the apps, in the orchestrator of them. So if you check here, if you see this here, what I'm doing there is I'm starting the Spring Cloud Admin on my machine, right? This is a Spring Boot app. So now I can bind my shell to this guy here and run my pipelines locally in my machine. The experience is the same as here, or can be on the cloud wherever you are. Same experience, always a Spring Boot application. Now, what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna run the I'm gonna bind this to my local machine now. So now I'm binding to my local machine. If you check here, you see that you receive the request. So now I can, if I do a stream list here, I have nothing here. Let's say that I want to create a very simple application, very simple, I have something in the pipeline here. Very simple, let's say that I want to create this tweet, I think. Right now I'm gonna run locally in my machine. So I'm gonna run this, what's that? I have to. So one thing that you have to do is when you start Spring Cloud Data Flow, you have to register your applications, right? So you need a catalog of applications to run. So when you start Data Flow doesn't know anything about your apps. So you have to say Data Flow, this is my catalog of applications. This is the application that I'd be able to use. So what I'm doing here is app import, I'm saying Data Flow, these are the apps that I want to import. Now I can use in my pipeline. I'm using this is from the, and another thing here that you check here is that I have a rabbit here. What that means, those applications, they can be connected via RabbitMQ. Then if you want to bring the ones that for Kafka, you're gonna have one for Kafka and so on. The point here is that now, after this, I'm gonna have a catalog of apps that I can use to create my pipeline. If I do this here, so now you see that all those apps are registered. So now I can have sources for, I have sync JDBC, I have source TCP, I have and so on, right? So one thing now is, if you check that, what I did was I'm using RabbitMQ, so I have to start RabbitMQ. What? Yeah. I just saying that now I have to start RabbitMQ. Because what I said was that I want to use the RabbitMQ. What's this? Yeah, now this, let me start Kafka because for some reason my broker is not. Let me bind this to the other one because let's try to run this on the cloud because now my RabbitMQ is not starting up for some reason, so I don't have much time to figure this out. So I'm gonna bind back. What I did now, I bind this back for the data flow in the cloud. That's this address here. And now, if I do a stream list here, I have what I had before, right? So let's say if I deploy foo. So it's very basic, just time log. Then after that, they're gonna deploy to it. So foo is deployed. So now if I check here, it's failing for some reason. Let's wait a bit. The demons of demos are not working properly, so. So keep answering the questions.
Any other questions? Probably we'll give it another 2-3 minutes. If not, probably we'll do it some other time. Any other questions? Yeah.
So from what I learned so far is that Cloud Foundry is like a some sort of to help you. AWS and
yeah. Think of it like an abstraction layer or an OS on top of your cloud.
So how does it compare with something else like Cloud Forms?
How does it? Cloud Forms is it?
Red Hat Cloud Forms.
Okay, Red Hat has this thing called OpenShift, which is comparable to the Cloud Foundry, but Have you heard of CloudForms before?
CloudForms, yeah, but I never use, so I don't know much about it. So what it does? What's the? So you create orchestration, you orchestrate apps as well. It's like Docker Compose, something like this.
It's something similar to what CloudForms create does. But you write code instead.
Okay, so the application running containers, so you have orchestrate of containers. How CloudForms works?
Is it a platform as a service, or is it?
It's more of a software as a service.
So we fall under a platform as a service. So Cloud Foundry is compared. It's like a platform as a service, and basically things. There are vendors like OpenShift who offers. They're running on Kubernetes and Dockers, whereas you have other vendors like IBM Bluemix. IBM has their own public cloud.
Hold on. So
is it done?
Yeah, so now I'm going to start the stream deploy.
So we are running everything on cloud, so probably takes few seconds.
Okay, so he deployed both. The first two string has been deployed, so now I'm deployed the final one, that's the tweets one, the one that connects and receives the tweets. It's deployed, so now if I go here, I'm learning this locally, so to avoid any. Not showing here. So the streams. These are the streams deployed, all the three streams. And now we should wait a bit to see the data comes in. And once the data is ready, you're going to show here in the dashboard. So then I can see the visualization. So if I want to check what's going on, so I can come here for my logs. So this is the Kafka. I'm using Kafka locally in my machine. This is the message broker that's moving the message around. And here, you see that something is crashing here, so I can check the logs. For some reason, the tweets cannot process. So the data is not flowing to the other parts of the.
Okay, well,
I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. Okay, thanks a lot for coming. And we probably will be conducting these sessions quite often. So probably next time we'll be able to show this demo.
I know what it is.
Yep.
It's ready. It's fix. It's ready. It's out. So now the data is gonna show. The data
Thank
goes
you
to
very
Redis.
Much.
So this is the demo that I. This is what I want to show. So Redis was out. So that's this is comes from the cloud. This comes from the tweets, and based on the size, it means how many. Words you have, how many tweets you have with that particular word, right? So this is the hashtags. And now I can have another one here that also is in real time. This one's for language. So you can see English, Spanish, Korean, and so on.
So all this changes in real time?
Those aggregations are be done by the tweet that I, by the things that I show you here, right? So. Tag count, receive the tweets, you see that tweet string? I get the tweets from there. Now I'm putting a counter. And I'm putting a counter aggregate by hashtags text. Right? So it's counting. Every time that's had real, 1, 2, 3, and keeps counting there inside Redis. Redis is the database they are using to do these analytics. The second one is by language. So I'm using here field name lang, name language. And now, if the language is English, put in the bucket English. If it's Spanish, put in the bucket Spanish, and so on. And finally, this is the guy that gets the tweets. So he doesn't do anything else. Gets the tweets, and now those two here process the tweets, right? I have three streams, one just to collect, another in two others to analyze. And based on this analysis here, if I go to the interface, I can see them running in here. So I put three pipelines together in order to get this analysis here. I didn't have to write one line of code, right? Because the Twitter application that consumes the tweet is already being written. The aggregation, I just use the DSL from Tweet itself, from Spring Cloud.flow itself, to say, count, use the field value counter, that's a application that counts things, based in the hashtag text. Use the field value counter based in the language. So I use this the DSL itself to do this very basic aggregation of data, but I didn't have to write any data for any code for this. And now I can see this here. So the point is that you can use Spring Cloud.flow process the data that you have. The data doesn't have to come from the cloud, doesn't have to come from the internet, can come from a file, can come from a database. Anything that you want to process on stream, you can do here. And if you want to process in batch as well, you can trigger the start of the batch from here as well. Questions?
Thanks for staying up late.
Thank you.
So, thanks.